What you're about to see has never been done before. This, I think, is without doubt the first time I've gone deeply into the things that matter most to me. People associate me with different names. Prince, petroleum engineer, project manager, politician.
Wow, I guess it's pretty lonely in this big house.
Yeah, it's not, you know, it would have been much better if my family was here with me, but you know, this is the life we live.
Ah,
this is a choice we have chosen.
Well, I'm sure that so, they understand.
They do.
But I prefer to see myself as a people's person.
But I'm very fulfilled and I'm very happy, but my only sadness is not enough young men and women have experienced what I've experienced. If we allow the current trend to continue, I don't know how many of them will have that experience. I don't want to be, you know, so prosperous while other people are so impoverished. I believe that rather than continue to rise, I'll wait for others to rise with me. And so that desire to see others succeed, that desire to see others benefit, that desire to see others thrive, for me is so important.
My name is Prince Tonye Princewill, and I approve this message.
It's almost like you're in a war zone. I mean, you're looking at water for as far as the eye can see, and homes just completely consumed by it. Yeah, so it's it was terrible. And then, of course, you know, we have, you know, reptiles anyway, so alligators, you know. We had snakes, and literally where a snake would have to crawl to get to a place, now they were just literally having fun. Unprecedented, and we felt that we had to do something as individuals, as an organization. And we didn't set up camps per se. What we did was we actually went out there and to a great extent helped people from within camps.
How many people do you have in this camp?
At this time we have 4,850.
Do you have the register?
It's there, it's there.
I'm sorry.
We provided food, we provided relief material, things like torchlights, mattresses, things that they would need cooking, even as basic as firewood. But what we found is that the traditional relief materials were not even what they wanted. They wanted things, for instance, like firewood, so that they could actually, nobody thinks, oh, let me go and give people firewood. People think I should give them indomie, I should give them this, but how would they cook?
How would they cook?
You know, to give them rice, but what stew would they eat it with, and so on and so forth. So we gave them stuff like that. Sending a cow to a camp was like, Christmas. All the most significant and surprising intervention that we provided, which, you know, blew my mind, was medical attention. I was shocked that when we went to a camp and we gave them relief material, we went initially with a few nurses and some drugs, and we found out that the queue for the nurses and the drugs would keep us there much longer. After distributing everything else, we're still sticking around because the nurses had not finished. So we doubled our nurses for further engagements, and then tripled our nurses and included doctors as well, so that we could see those people and attend to them a lot quicker than we were doing previous.
They give medicine. I don't even know that I give one. Make him not come back again.
And of course, what was frightening about it is that even people who were expected to provide support to these people were also affected. I went to one of the camps and I met some nurses administering drugs, and they told me that every day that they're administering these drugs, they don't have homes. And me and my team, there were times that we had to sleep on the road inside our cars, because naturally, you're going to go and help people who have no homes. So which home will you have? Sometimes when we talk about the philanthropy and all those things, I get a little sad because a lot of people sort of link it to politics.
To politics.
They say you're doing it because you have political ambitions.
It's been there for the people before partisan politics. He always is touched, he's really touched by the plight of the people. And so he does what he can.
Parental input is vital in helping us to shape who we become. And orphans are hugely disadvantaged as they miss out on such key input in the crucial stages of their lives.
These orphans deserve an opportunity that will maximize their full potential, just like any other kid out there.
Melody Shelters, a singing competition for the different orphanages in Nigeria.
Yeah, it's proper training. They'll go places.
Melody Shelters.
Melody Shelters.
Leaving no one.
Leaving no one behind.
Melody Shelters. Leaving no one behind.
I was so proud of that project. It was so rewarding because what we were looking for really was, rather than just give, we had, you know, myself, my partner in that, Adonis Productions, and all that were involved in that project, all had a passion for orphans. And, you know, making a difference to orphans was something that we took pleasure in doing. But we were thinking, hang on, just go to an orphanage and you sort of drop a little bit of money with them and you walk away. Is that really the best way to go about it? And then, of course, you go to the orphanages and you hear them sing for you and they entertain you. And you think to yourself, well, come, these guys, they have a talent here.
What I see is the love shining bright as the sun comes out. We are Kings Kick representing GB, ever blazing, elevating, upgrading. Yes, everybody now.
So it was a combination of those two extremes. Like, okay, let's just stop handing money to them. Let's get them to work for it. And we felt that we could also get people to see behind the banner, orphan or orphanage. What we did, first of all, was to get a short list of orphanages in Nigeria. And we got that from the Ministry of Women Affairs. I think several orphanages around the country obviously were there, but we had to now go state by state, region by region. And the whole idea was to sort of do an audition where you would showcase their talent and then bring them to one central location where the finalists would compete. So we went around the whole country. There was an immense number of orphanages, but we couldn't take all of them. 8 orphanages were finally shortlisted, and they were all brought to one location in Port Harcourt.
Once we get these 8 finalists, all the 8 will now be camped in a place, right? There's going to be a house for this competition, and all the 8 will be camped in that house. That is where you will live for at least 2 weeks throughout the duration of the competition. So everything that happens in the home is going to be televised. Everybody's going to see it. People are going to send text messages to vote, to vote for the orphanage that wants to remain in the house until we get to the final one. Right?
Are you ready?
Yeah!
Are you ready for now to shelter?
God, if I can have 10 million naira, my children are the priority.
Yeah.
As you have known, we are talking of our friends. At least we will do a bit so that people will see and also put a helping hand. And then my children's education is important.
Money like that, it would give me the peace of mind that all of my children that are capable of higher education will get it. So when I heard it first, I thought, oh my goodness, is that possible? Maybe they're just kidding. Maybe they wouldn't do it. But I'm thinking, boy, if we should get something like that, I tell you, that would be a miracle. That would be a gift from above. It just would be God looking out for us.
So we come into, is it real or just a dream? I don't know.
This is all real.
Because many people come here, we never see them come back.
This is real.
What we did was we took a whole hotel. The whole hotel was I want to call it shut down for this purpose. The film crew had a different hotel, the orphans and their guides, or let me call them their escorts, had another. And the whole place was shut down. And over the course of a couple of weeks, we had to slowly and surely whittle them down until we had 3 finalists. God's Will Orphanage from Kogi State was the winner, and they went home with 10 million cash.
I have the pleasure to present to you the winners of season 1, Adonis Production, Kogi State Orphanage!
This is an orphanage that was actually attacked before they came for the competition. And armed robbers came into the orphanage and literally beat the living daylights out of the matron and frightened, of course, the young children. And one of the reasons why that could even possibly happen is because it's just an open place.
To Melody Shelter, thank you. You have been an encouragement to come round to where we are hiding in a hideout, to look for us and to change our lives. your children's life will be changed. Your life also will be changed.
The second was lifetime caring orphanage from River State. They went home with 5 million. The third orphanage went home with 3 million, I think, and I think we gave 500,000 naira to the other five that didn't finish.
500,000 consolation prize.
Consolation prize, yeah, each.
Oh.
Get into the new year, we'll start to put in place the logistics to make sure it happens, but definitely 2013 is going to be bigger than 2012, even financially.
Looking forward to that. Beautiful. Leaving the world
behind. Genuine philanthropy, you know, is found where you use your own personal resources to get involved. And once you get your personal resources involved, it means that, you know, you put your money where your mouth is. One of his foundational philosophy is, you know, you're blessed to bless others.
It's important that we actually, you know, take time to reach out to the women. I mean, if you ask me, the women are the key. You know, if you can take care of the women, then the children are taken care of. And I think the children are our future.
So you do this in forms of loans?
Yeah.
Short-term loans to these women?
Yeah, there are a variety of schemes. I don't believe in one size fitting all. Princewill's Trust, of course, is the charity organization, but this is actually, what we're doing for the women is actually going through Princewill Political Associates. So, okay. It does have some political undertones to it, but, you know, no apologies.
Be our women! B and B and A women!
So I think politics is affecting everybody's life. And so, to me, it just does not make sense that we will be looking at the politics and doing nothing about it. Well, there are two main things that we're doing. You have to remember that I've been working with the women and the women groups, well, most of my political associates, since 2006, when I ventured into politics for the first time. And I'm proud to say that quite a few of them have stayed steadfast with me, even though I don't have this, what you call, traditional political appointment, by which most people keep themselves up and above.
Please help us and give to our first lady.
First lady, thank you.
One of the schemes is actually microfinance. So actually giving women money and getting them to use that money to do business, trade, you know, complement what they currently have, and ultimately pay it back to a pool from when other women can also come and benefit. One of the good things about working with women for so long is that I have, you know, I've identified those that are trustworthy and reliable. So the only way you can truly test somebody's trust is to give them a chance to fail. And, you know, I have had examples of women who haven't done so well, but they've learned from their lessons. So you take the scheme from here and you give it to another one there. And we've been able to, by trial and error, get a model that works and then use the successful people to model across others. And it's worked. So that's with the microfinance scheme. The other thing we do is skills acquisition. So the women said to me that they really they want machines that can help make plastic bags. And those plastic bags can be used in the market to trade. So it just made sense to me. So I bought the equipment that makes the plastic bags, gave them the raw material to make the plastic bags, and I scattered them across various LGAs.
Oh, so that's something working right now?
Yeah, it's working now. If you come to the fields, go to various local governments, you see the women generating these bags, selling these bags, making money. And the idea is that the equipment that I've given them, in each local government, about 10 machines. So those 10 machines are in a center, somewhere, say, the headquarters of the local government. But as they sell and sell, they keep spreading it out into further, more even rural areas. And the idea is that, you know, they can now generate their own businesses.
Is there any form of partnership, you know, with the government, the Ministry of Women Affairs?
No. I tried to partner with the government, but it was seen as political.
Okay.
when I gave money to a government agency, there was a big scream. Oh, who is this man? Does he think he's government? You know, so people thought this young man was getting too carried away. So I didn't mean anything by it. I really liked what the microfinance agency was doing. And in my heart, I thought, if they're doing such a good job of managing government money, then maybe some of us should encourage them even further and give them money. And I did. But when it started getting too political and there was a long delay before they released the money to the women, I said, give me my money back.
Have you ever thought about health?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. You know, the problem I have is that I can't do everything. But, you know, in terms of health, there are some areas that are particularly of interest to me. For instance, cancer. And the care, treatment, prevention of...
Why is cancer of interest?
Well, because, you know, it's annoying. 4 out of every 5 diagnoses ends up fatal. In other words, out of, you know, 5 people that walk into a room to complain about cancer, 4 don't make it. And cancer doesn't know age, doesn't know religion, doesn't know creed.
It can happen to anybody.
And it also can happen at any age. It just baffles me that as a country, we have, you know, several hundred million people and we're not able to cater for this. It just doesn't make any sense. And I'm not a medical doctor myself, but it shouldn't be rocket science. And it appears to be.
You've been thinking along that lines. Can we expect anything anytime soon?
Well, I think, you know, there will probably be collaborations. I mean, yesterday I had people in my office who were talking about setting up a world-class cancer center in Port Harcourt. And the budget is $63 million. And I think if there's a well-put-together collaboration, it can happen.
It can work.
Yeah, and of course, the people who are pushing it are doctors, credible doctors. So that's something I'm looking at. Difficult. I mean, I don't think I'm on a mission. So to me, it's like
a face.
Yes, a face is like work.
Well, your wife has been really supportive along.
Absolutely. I mean, if not for Rosemary, there'll be no way I'll make this happen. It's impossible. The fact that you can go and face what you're doing and not bother and just relax and be relaxed is because you have a woman at home that makes sure that, you know. But I look forward to going back, of course, anytime. And every time I go back, she makes me better. She makes me stronger. So when I come back, it's like going back to fill up your tank.
Is she as interested in politics as you are?
She's not so much interested in politics. She's interested in people.
You met her here in Nigeria?
Uniport, yeah. She was a student of the University of Port
Harcourt. Oh, really? Yeah. Okay.
And even though we didn't quite hit it off in university, we're just friends. A cousin of mine was a friend of hers, and that's how we met. But when we got to London, I was able to track her down. What attracted me to her was singing. She sings.
Oh, really?
Yes, and I also sing as well. So that's what attracted me to her. I remember we used to do duets, and we'd be singing, we'd be strolling and singing, and that was what attracted me to her. But then...
So you sing too?
Yeah.
That brings the question, what can't you do? What can't you do?
I can't make money singing. How is that? I try as much as I can to keep my wife abreast of what I'm doing. Sometimes in unconscious ways, sometimes in very direct and deliberate manners. These days with the social media, whatever you're doing is public knowledge. And my wife and my kids, you know, sometimes they know about what I'm doing even before I tell them. And yeah, they keep abreast of what's going on. And that's quite useful to me. The reason I'm doing all of this is because of them. It's inevitable that I will be here. And ultimately my family has to be here. We all have to be here. But I'm here as, let's just call it the advanced team, to come and clear the road. So once I've done that, they will come and we'll live happily, because Nigeria is a place where there's so much opportunity. There's no reason for anybody to leave. So I have my dad here, I have my stepmom here, I have brothers, I have sisters, I have what you want to call the kingdom of Calabar and all.
Of which you are the prince.
Well, which I've, yes. my responsibilities there, of course, are constant. But then there's the political family as well, because I'm very particular that we should play politics of brotherliness, of brotherhood. So my political allies are also my family as well. So I have a huge family, big family. Don't know this, but I have a very genuine and sincere and very intense love for entertainment. As bad as Nigeria is perceived on the outside, we still have our movies that is giving us life. We still have our music that is giving us life. So music and movies especially are still giving Nigeria a good image, are still promoting Nigeria. And those two industries are doing it with little or no help from the government. So I just think that's wrong. And I think that as an individual, whatever I can do to help Nollywood or the entertainment industry, I want to do that. We started with about 670 applicants. So we had to screen 670 people. But they were in three different categories: music, dance, and comedy.
Please identify where Silver Bay day. The man, Nakalaba, the man, the police, but now calling somebody again. Okay, he never, you see, on Silver Bay. I say, yes, sir. Okay, just, on the day. On the day. On the day go, on the day, on the day go. Moto go, pass view, just, on the day.
For instance, the best artist got 5 million naira recording deal. He wanted 5 million cash in his pocket. So that didn't work. But you know, the important thing is to make sure that you give them at least 5 million naira worth of support. So cash, yes, a monthly salary, yes, a new house, yes, change of clothes, yes, you name it. Constantly in the studio. 24/7 is already knocking out a single.
What's his name?
His name is Timmy Julius.
Timmy Julius.
Yes, and he's from Bayelsa State. He's quite good hairdresser. No previous experience.
Wow.
Yeah, so he's done well. Watch, you know, these music videos, you see the dancers involved in it. I thought to myself, why can't we promote both? You know, you promote the musician, you promote the dancer. So that was there. That group took a 2 million naira deal home.
Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for the thrillers.
And then the comedians, I actually took two on the night, even though I was planning to just take one. Both took a 1 million naira deal.
What are their names?
One of them's name is Usher. And he's a welder, living in Abacha. He won. You know, I Go Talk, who is also funny, didn't win. He came second. But I decided to sign him anyway.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner is Jacob John.
But going back to Osha, is Abacha, living with his wife. He had nothing. He was performing for 5,000 naira here, there, and everywhere. So when he wins this 1 million naira deal, we couldn't calm him down. He was jumping over the place. We had to calm him down. Then first of all, tell him that we're not giving you 1 billion naira. We say, oh guy, don't care. Even if 1,000 naira, stuff, I don't win. We gave them money. In his case, again, just like with Timmy Julius, we got him a new house. And with all of them, we changed their clothing. From the dancers, everybody, we gave them an allowance for clothing. Of course, again, he has.
So you're going to keep nurturing those talents? Yes. On the contrary, young man, and possibly more or less, not definitely rejected the idea that is not with any way amount of uncertainty. I don't know where he shouldn't be, if that indeed wasn't where he is in. Even if he wouldn't where I know he could be, means I know where he is not. Policeman, answer yes, sir.
These acts are signed to Riverdale Entertainment.
Oh, there is Riverdale Entertainment.
They're signed to Riverdale Entertainment. We have consultants working with them. We have in-house staff working with them. And the idea is that as time goes on, we build and develop that brand to the point where you now bring other acts, not necessarily from the talent shows, but other acts signing to Riverdale Entertainment. I mean, you know, I'm having discussions with the band, you know, I'm having discussions with other people. So who knows what tomorrow? It's too early to say anything. But my idea is to take people who, just like in my politics, I take people who can't get into the political scene into politics. I take people who can't get into the entertainment scene into entertainment.
If you have to choose between being an actor, a musician, a dancer, a comedian, but you're so involved in all of this, which one would you be?
If I act, then who is going to produce now? So one of the things I like doing is I like people to do their own thing. Some people ask me, say, you're an engineer. Why are you calling somebody to come and engineer things for you? I said, well, make everyone do their work. If you try to do everything, you don't want to be a jack of all trade. If I'm the producer and I start to act, then actors know we'll get space now.
So are you saying that you really love to act?
No, I'd love to act at some point, but truthfully, you know, my hands are full from production already. Are you sure I'm not acting now? I'd rather be supporting the artists, and I'm more interested in politics and how to change society as a whole. I think singers and actors are very good with what they do, but they can't make the kind of change that I want to make.
You really love the arts. There's a constant theme, you know, and that's boats and rivers. Is that because you're River State, or you have something with boats and rivers?
I don't think it's unconnected. I think there's probably something there, but you know, I have a love for the water. It's unbelievable. In fact, sometimes I have to wish I was a fish. Apart from the terrible smell. But there's no water here. I mean, this is rural life again.
Okay, and, this is rural life.
Yeah. But I think the common...
If I were to judge, I would say these paintings kind of like helps you keep connected, yeah, you know, to where you're from.
Absolutely. I think for me, the message that you get here is our ability to survive in spite of
all the conditions.
Yeah, I mean, you can. I say in spite of, and then I leave it blank. It's entirely. Everybody can write a script from there.
State has just been assassinated. Seal up all the bloody exits.
It looks to me like you still don't know why you're here, Captain.
10,000 innocent public officials have been dismissed without benefit.
I am a soldier, not a politician.
Come on, baby, leave me alone! Sissy, I want to see my husband!
I'm a soldier's widow. I know the pain and anguish I went through when my husband died in the battle.
Was your husband here that night?
No!
I need to know what's going on in my brother's house!
They are taking the co-plotters to Lagos. If you do not speak out, my husband will be executed.
If I speak out, I could be charged with concealment of treason, and that attracts the death penalty.
Okay.
my husband missing.
But 76 is based on, or based around, a true story. The events that surrounded the assassination of Murtala Mohammed in 1976. And it's taken from a different perspective, from the perspective of the wives
of the soldiers
that were involved in that. The real message there was that we're dealing with a true life story. And we're dealing again at the time when Nigeria as a country was just, you know, slowly getting more and more divided. And I like the script. I like the whole Nigerian concept of it. Hollywood has molded American perception inside America and outside of America. It's no secret that you find that you're doing a wartime movie and the US Army wants to be involved in it. They want to make sure that the story is told.
It's told right.
Yeah, so, you know, the collaboration between Washington and Los Angeles is known. The collaboration between Bollywood and Indian government is also known. We haven't quite got it right here yet, but we will.
What do politicians love watching?
Politicians love watching money being counted. Sports is something that our state takes very seriously. But of course, I as an individual, I take it very seriously as well. I actually think that sports is a very healthy, component or part of any successful person's life. I think that through sports, you can start to begin to encourage competition and so on and so forth. I'll give you a typical example. The polo club in Port Harcourt. Many people just see it as that polo club. But the polo club is actually a mecca for conversation, networking, communication. People who want to have, you know, it's like a social club. You go out there.
For the rich?
Well, I wouldn't quite describe us as rich. In River State, there are quite a few people who are, you know, unemployed and below the what you might call the poverty line. But you can have a drink, you know. Not everybody can afford a drink, but quite a few people can.
So, how did you get involved with the polo club?
Well, I remember back in 2006, 2007, when I took an interest in politics, was the same time the state was boiling. It was really, people were being assassinated. It was just madness. And one of the few places you could go to in Port Harcourt and really relax and have yourself a good time was the polo club. So recently I gave them some money to build a pavilion.
You play the game yourself?
I don't. I was fortunate enough to learn how to ride horses when I was small. But mine was for leisure, for active sports. And that was because I grew up in the north and my father was kind enough to make the sacrifice. So yes, but I haven't played it actively and I doubt if I'm prepared to do it now. Because if I fall off a horse, have you seen those guys play polo? Running around trying to hit a ball. I mean,
it's crazy.
Yeah.
And so which of the games do you play?
Football. I'd much rather play football. Football is a sport that it's heavy contact. You know, one doesn't heal as quickly as one used to.
You're a big Man U fan.
I am. I am very big Man U fan. But if you cut my blood, it's red. Apparently, Chelsea fans, if you cut their blood, it's blue. God help them. But mine is red. And
you also love car racing, I gather?
I do. Formula One is another sport that I find. Machines. I'm an engineer. I love machinery. This t-shirt speaks volumes.
Okay.
Okay, so
it says a lot of things.
You walk around, you let it answer all the questions.
Yeah, okay. it answers some questions, but it also poses some. But it's nice. It's part of the conversation. Okay,
this is perfect. So what we're going to do is I'm going to get a copy, my t-shirt, and then we're going to point one after the other, and then we'll talk about it because I can see PPA. Can we see PPA?
Yep.
Principal political associates.
Yes.
I can see. GBK Rotimi Amechi.
Yeah, my good friend.
Blessed to bless, we believe. Oh, this is the River Joe Group.
Absolutely.
No Fear, Niger Delta, Rivers First, Dialogue, Heart Equals Height.
Absolutely.
That's powerful.
Absolutely.
And on the arm, the short arm, we have Delta Plus, we have Alba Rock Africa. Oh, we have PDP, we'll talk about that too.
Well, don't forget the back. The back also has a few things to say as well.
What else is here?
Oh, these are some of my other companies.
Intellister, Energy.
This is a political movement that many people who are politicians know about.
We have all this, and then you can talk about every one of it.
Absolutely. I mean,
let's.
And like I said, there are some companies that are complaining they're not here. So.
My name's Adrian. I met Tonye. Firstly, in 2002, and at that stage, I was representing a European technology company looking to establish a business in Nigeria. And the idea was to set up with an indigenous Nigerian oil field service company. And Tonye had such a company in Riverdrill, and together we expanded the scope of Riverdrill. And so Delta Plus was born. That was in 2002.
In 2007, we started to employ young engineers and technicians, and they were working with our partner offshore Nigeria on their vessels. They have been trained during 2 or 3 years, and today they even replace expatriates on this vessel, and they are working offshore in North Sea with our partners.
What I would say, having been involved with the company since inception, is that he's been singly focused on a vision of empowering the Nigerian workforce, the Nigerian community in which we work in, and also engaging with government to assist them in understanding the value of their assets. So this has been, I think, very helpful for us in meeting our ambitions of fulfilling a role as a Nigerian company. So we're one of the first Nigerian companies in our market segment that has achieved that. And that's largely due to his stewardship.
TNG was set up probably about 2 years ago, and the whole, I guess, motivation for that was, you know, as much as you have a lot of passion to do things, the big problem we have is Nigeria is that the younger generation, don't seem to be very motivated to make any difference. I was troubled that it appeared in many cases or instances that I was actually more concerned about the situation that people were in than they were for themselves. And it constantly baffled me, and it suddenly occurred to me that probably one reason or one of the reasons why many people don't do very much is that they actually don't think they can make a difference. If you want to change Nigeria, you can't do it on your own. It needs to be done as a group. And so the Change Nigeria group was formed for that purpose. When we started off, there were about 30-something of us, and that number slowly was pruned down to now we have 10. It all started as a BlackBerry group. That's probably why the number was restricted to about 30, because that's how many you can have in a BlackBerry group. So it started as a BlackBerry group, but We went to Ghana, for instance, we're in Accra. We met with the local government minister. We met with the own equivalent of INEC. And really what we're trying to get them to understand is that you don't have to be a rocket scientist to see development. Ghana is a significantly poorer country than Nigeria is. You know, they have a system that works and they have institutions that make sense. I got them to Dubai because I wanted them to see how you could, from zero, and we're talking about one of the newest cities in the world, we're talking about how you can show people how way from zero can create so much. A place that had oil before but doesn't have oil anymore. I was able to introduce them to the people who were there beginning, who had created Dubai. The royal family, the businessmen behind the scenes, the investors. I got them to understand what it took to create Dubai. CNG is a sum of its parts, and as a group, we're all doing individual projects, but we're coming together very soon for a TV program, which is going to be like the hot seat, where you have people, you put them on the seat, and if they can survive the hot seat, then you know that they know they have the capacity. That's another meeting, of course. That's Atiku, somebody I describe as my few people, very few people I have respect for in politics as much as him. He's a politician. I like his personality. I like the kind of person he is. And then, of course, him, Amechi as well. The other person that I would class as a seasoned politician would be Asiwaju.
Bola Ametinubu.
Yes. So I call them the triple A. I add Timi Alaibe into that as well. Four A's.
You didn't start out as a politician at all. You started out as a businessman, just like an ordinary Nigerian, you know, with the Nigerian dream, okay? And then you got into politics because, like you said, you wanted to get involved. What was it like?
Well, I mean, my own route to politics basically was, I was tired of complaining. I got involved in politics after there was a community crisis that I witnessed in my community, and I watched a reversal of roles where the traditional institutions were being, you know, decimated and denigrated, and the political institutions were, you know, getting away with murder, putting it mildly. So I just felt that political institutions needed to be infiltrated, so to speak. So this is me, I'm a spy. When I contested for AC, for governorship, I contested under AC.
That was
2007. And now I'm in PDP, and many people can't quite get it, especially because they don't think I talk like a PDP person. PDP people usually are more interested in PDP than they are in their community. And, you know, that's the impression that Nigerians have. Forget my impression, this is the impression that Nigerians have. So when they see somebody in PDP talking against that, they say, ah, no, this one is not really PDP. It's AC. And I remind them there's no longer AC. So that party no longer exists. It's now ACN. But, you know, one of the big worries for me is that people don't actually get it. That parties don't stand for anything. Nigerian political parties don't stand for anything. So if you're in this party or that party, it is not because of what your beliefs are. It's only because maybe you have a couple of friends here, or you have a couple of friends there, or just maybe you can see a route to victory. Nigerians don't understand that political parties are supposed to have policies on education. They're supposed to have policies on health. They're supposed to have policies on minimum wage. So that if you're in a political party, you know what your party believes in, you know what your party stands for, you know what your party represents. But in Nigeria, political parties don't represent anything. And so the move between political parties is not actually a reflection of a lack of principles or ideals on the part of the individual. It's a lack of principles and ideals on the part of the party. We're intellectually lazy. What the party needs to do is sit down and ask themselves, where do we stand on a variety of issues? Take positions. put it out to the leadership, sorry, to the membership. Let them take a vote on it. If we're saying free education, what is free education? What does it imply? And if that is the case, any governor or any party that wins, any candidate, sorry, that wins in a state knows what he stands for. For instance, somebody may say, I don't believe in free education. So why are you flying the flag of a party that is talking about free education? Do you understand? So what should happen is that the politicians should be much more intellectual and Nigerians should be much more intellectual, because Nigerians, what I'm saying is Greek to some Nigerians. But let me just also point out to you that we have Goodluck Jonathan and Yar'Adua, same party, same ticket, two different governments, because that absence of continuity should be laid in the foundation of the party, not in the individual. Now, over to Tonye Princewill. Now, I contested in 2007 and I did so with passion. I remember when I joined AC, maybe people who are outside can't speak, but I can tell you I contested for governorship under the platform of the party. Nobody told me this is what we stand for. I fought a very, let me call it a vigorous campaign. And after the elections, we took a very strategic decision. We said that we will allow Amechi to go. My state and its development was my priority, not that I had to be governor. The development of the state, I felt, was priority. And rather than distracting Amechi with legal battles, I felt it was imperative that we allow him the free road to go and work.
When you supported Atiku against Jonathan, then was it because you knew Atiku as a person and you understand his ideologies enough to believe it was what Nigeria needed?
In politics, and especially in Nigeria, people will expect you to carry naturally ethnic. So they will say, well, okay, yeah, Niyi is a good man, but Wabi is my brother. So forget Niyi. And I don't do that. That's not the way I operate. You see, people are wired differently. And if you're wired that way, fine with you. But I'm not wired that way. So I will choose a presidential candidate based on those criteria. I'm tired because many of us are carrying Nigerian problems on our head. We're tired of doing that. What we want is a government that will wake up and be alive to its responsibilities. So people have started talking about 2015, and I think rightly so. I definitely will be there or thereabouts in 2015 if God grants me life. Can't take anything for granted. But what position and, you know, how I play that role is yet to be defined. God knows that if I have enough money, I would rather run for president. Because in my opinion, it is not just River State that needs changing, it's Nigeria. I'm hoping that I can trigger people's consciences. I think Nigerians need to be a lot more conscientious. And if their leadership, Amechi is my friend, but if I'm not happy with anything he does, I criticize him. When he decided to buy a plane, I criticize him. Yeah, because that's genuinely how I felt. He could potentially be offended by it. Thankfully, he's not the kind of person who gets so offended. But if he was offended by it, then too bad. You know, but to say that I will not say it, it's not possible. I have to tell him, on record, this is my position. If he chooses not to listen to me, which is his prerogative, that's fine. But let it be on record that I have said it. Yeah. Wow. Of course, the same applies to Jonathan. You know, I didn't support Jonathan for 2011.
Oh, you didn't?
No, I didn't support him.
Oh, you were with who? Atiku?
I was with Atiku. Okay, to be fair, when Atiku lost the primary, I looked at Ribadu, looked at Buhari, and looked at Jonathan, and Jonathan was the better of the three. So, yes.
For
me. Now, there's no way. There's no way you can tell me Buhari is better than Jonathan. You cannot tell me
the because he's from the Niger Delta.
No. So amongst the three of them, Jonathan was best, in my opinion.
Can you still say that now?
Yes, I can still say that now. If you ask me to do it again, I would.
You can walk out in front of Nigeria and still say Jonathan is the best.
Of the three, yes. Jonathan's strength is that he cares, but he has some significant faults.
We won't talk about that now.
Why not? Let's feel free to talk about
you
it.
You want us to talk about that in this pool?
Why not?
Oh, okay.
Why not? I mean, Jonathan has his significant faults, but I don't look at him and think to myself, that guy is not a good man. I don't get that impression. I think that he means well. I think that he's never been president before, so he's bound to make mistakes. He's not autocratic. He is almost submissive. That's his personality. He's not rude. He didn't get to where he got to by Gagra. So we're not going to expect to see Gagra from him now. In fact, Jonathan's rise to presidency is the work of G.O.D. Do you understand? Just like Amechi's rise to governor was the work of G.O.D. So when I see G.O.D.'s handwriting... When I see G.O.D.'s handwriting, I don't fight it. So let's encourage him, pray for him as much as possible. But am I happy with the government of today? No, I'm not. Look, Jonathan can still turn things around. If he surrounds himself with the right kind of advice, if he listens... Look, when Jonathan gave Ojukwu a hero's funeral, it made a huge difference in certain parts of the community. When Jonathan ensured free and fair elections in Edo State, Ondo State, several states, when he appointed Jega as chairman of INEC, look, there's some very good things the man has done. So let's give the man credit where credit is due. You voted for him to be there for 4 years. You need to give him 4 years to do what he has to do. If after 4 years you're not happy with him, then you know how to express yourself. But you know, that's where the phrase comes. Politics is too important to be left to politics.
So we'll wait and see.
When the time comes, you get involved. And then you choose who your leader should be. But if a flood comes and removes your house, don't complain. If that leader that you have chosen does not respond to your needs. I want other people who are in a better position than me to see what I'm doing and hopefully push them to also do more.